Good evening, everyone, and thank you for coming to our Bible study class. And the first thing we're going to do is pray. Bow your heads. Father God, in the name of Jesus, God, we thank you for allowing us to be here today to read your word, to study your word. God, help us to understand your word, that we can live by your word. And we know you will be pleased, and we shall be blessed. We say thank you, God, in the precious name of your son, Jesus. Amen. Amen. Today, or this evening, we're going to have what we call real talk. And we want to get you all to participate with anything you would like to add or like to say during this discussion. Our topic for the evening is in the form of a question. And the question is, does everyone need to be saved? Does everyone need to be saved? How do you all feel about it? Anybody got any feedback on this question that you would like to say something? Yes.
Yes. Know that everyone needs to be saved. Everybody's not going to be saved. But hell was not made for God's creation of man. Hell was made for the devil and the angels that sin. But everybody needs to be saved.
Amen.
Because for Jesus to come down here and die with him, and what they did to him, there's something horrible waiting for those that are not saved. You need to be saved.
Great.
Thank you. Does anybody like to add anything to that?
Yeah. I'm sorry. Go ahead, bro. Yeah, I mean, what Sister Johnson said is, I'm going to put a continuation on it. We say saved, and we've been taught saved from what? That's the big question. That's a $64 million question. What are we going to be saved? What is he saving us from? Now, he's not saving us from death, but we all got to go.
Right, right.
And we all going to die.
Right.
So he ain't talking about that. But then when you read and study the Bible, you find out there's a second death. That's what he's trying to save you from. Because remember, God is justice. And people say, oh, God won't do this, oh, he won't do that.
Right.
In his righteousness, he got to do it.
That's right. Yeah.
Because the righteousness is a fulfillment of righteousness.
Right.
And being judged and being punished for wrong is a part of righteousness.
Right.
So he's been right the whole time, and he's going to continue to be right. So at the end of the day, he's going to be right.
Yeah.
Because he's going to make it right. And once again, I say this, I'll make it real quick. We got to stop believing this is about us.
Right.
This is about God.
Mm-hmm.
And when you can figure that out, maybe you'll get in line.
Thank you. Yes.
I would just like to add, I agree with everything Brother Ben and Sister Johnson said. In answer to your question, Bishop, does everyone need to be saved? As they both said, I would say yes, because just like there's a need for air to breathe, you know, food to eat, water to drink in order to survive, you need to be saved in order to survive the wrath of God.
Thank you. Anyone else like to add anything?
And I'll finish it off with, they all said that you need to be saved. But we all know that, like Ben said, what are you saved from? We know that. But we all need to be. But there's going to be a whole lot of people who choose not to.
Right.
So that's just it. So we need to be, but there's a whole lot of people that's going to choose not to.
Yeah.
Thank you. Thank you for your response, the responses that we received. and what we want to do now, because I think we all are in agreement that everyone needs to be saved.
Yes.
What we want to do now, let's take it to the Word of God.
Yes.
And let the Bible speak for itself.
Yes.
What does it mean to be saved?
Good question.
The word saved means the act of saving or protecting from harm, risk, loss, and destruction. And the religious definition of saved is to be delivered from sin and from spiritual death, to be rescued from eternal punishment, and this is known as salvation. And the theology definition of salvation is to be delivered from the power and penalty of sin. Now one may ask, what is sin? The word sin means an immoral act considered to be a transgression. Transgression is an act that goes against a law, rule, or code of conduct, an offense against divine law. That's what sin is. So the next question one may ask, has everyone sinned? Has everyone sinned? Well, if you believe in the Holy Bible, the answer is yes. Deacon Ward, read what God's word says about everyone has sinned.
Start from Romans chapter 3, verse 23, and I'll be reading from the King James Version. For all have sinned and come short of the glory of God.
For all have sinned and come short of the glory of God. Everyone has sinned. One may ask, how did everyone sin? You said everyone has sinned. How did everyone sin? Well, let's get an answer from the Word of God. Deacon Ward, please read.
Romans chapter 5, verse 12, and also the King James Version. Wherefore, as by one man sin entered into the world, and death by sin, and so death passed upon all men, for that all have sinned.
Now, as stated in Romans 5 and 12, we know the man in the scripture that Deacon Moore just read is Adam. You can read about this event and what happened in the third chapter of the book of Genesis in the Bible. As by one man, sin entered into the world, and death by sin. So death passed upon all men, for that all have sinned. This is the Word of God. If someone does not want to believe it, show it to them in the Word. And again, if they don't want to believe the Word, there's nothing else to discuss. What we want to do is make it very simple, very simple, that people can understand that the Bible says everyone has sinned. Well, the next question someone may ask, well, what is the consequence of sin? What's going to happen to people that sin? Well, let's go to the Word of God. Deacon Moore.
Sure. Romans chapter 6, verse 23, King James Version. For the wages of sin is death, but the gift of God is eternal life through Jesus Christ our Lord.
For the wages of sin is death, but the gift of God is eternal life through Jesus Christ our Lord. But the consequence of sin is death. And you may ask, what death are you talking about?
Right.
What death are you talking about? Everybody dies. The physical death. Is that what you're talking about? Well, let's read the Word of God. Deacon Moore?
Sure. We read in Matthew chapter 25, verse 41 from the King James Version. Then shall he say also unto them on the left hand, depart from me, ye cursed, into everlasting fire, prepared for the devil and his angels.
Brother Ben, continue. Okay.
Yes, I'll be reading from Revelation 21 and 8. But the fearful and the unbelievers and the abominable and the murderers and the whoremongers and the sorcerers and the idolaters and all liars shall have their part in the lake which burns with fire and brimstone, which is the second death.
Second death?
Let's talk about this for a moment. Because there are people that don't believe this. They think that we're not supposed to take what is said literally.
They sure do.
Well, let's go back to what Jesus said. He's talking about those on the left, those on the right, meaning the unrighteous and the righteous. And he will say to those on the left that are not saved, depart from me, ye cursed, into everlasting fire. And as was said a moment ago, this fire was not created for mankind.
No, right.
Jesus says it was prepared for the devil and his angels. When we talk about hell, we talk about hellfire. It was not created for us. But Jesus said, if you are on the left, meaning you are not saved, this is where you're going. Why? Why? Because Revelation 21:8 tells us the fearful, unbelieving. Unbelieving in who? Unbelieving in Jesus. The abominable. Doing things that are against God's laws. Murderers. Whoremongers. Sorcerers. Witchcraft. Idolaters. You are serving other gods.
Yeah.
Anytime you put anything before God, that is your God. But God wants to be first. He will take second to no one. He's the creator. And all liars. All liars.
All of them.
shall have their part in the lake which burneth with fire and brimstone, which is the second death. And that goes back to what is said, that the consequence in Romans 6 and 23, the wages of sin is death.
Right.
This is the death he's talking about.
Yeah.
The second death. And again, if someone chooses not to believe this, that's their choice. The word of God speaks for itself.
Right.
Now that we heard this, someone may ask, how can I be saved? How can I be saved? Mm-hmm. Well, let's go to the Word of God and see what the Word of God says. How can we be saved? Brother Ben, read.
Romans 5:8-11. But God commanded his love towards us in that while we were yet sinners, Christ died for us.
God showed his love towards everyone. That while we were sinners, Jesus Christ died for us. No one else could do it but Jesus Christ. And since Jesus cried for us, Jesus Christ died for us. Read, Brother Ben.
Much more then, being now justified by his blood, we shall be saved from the wrath through him.
Now that we have been justified by the blood of Jesus Christ, the word of God says we shall be saved from wrath through him. What wrath are you talking about? I just read it. The second death. That is the wrath of God. God's final wrath for the unsaved. Read.
For if, when we were enemies, we were reconciled to God by the death of his son, much more, being reconciled, we shall be saved by life.
We are no longer enemies to God. Why? Because we have been reconciled to God by the death of his son, Jesus Christ. We now have life. We are now saved. By his life. Read.
And not only so, but we also joy in God through our Lord Jesus Christ, by whom we have now received the atonement.
We have received forgiveness. Through Jesus Christ. Through Jesus Christ. Well, what does Hebrew 7:25 say? Read, Brother Ben.
Hebrew 7:25, King James Version. Wherefore, if he's able also to save them to the utmost that comes unto God by him, seeing he ever lives to make intercession for them.
This scripture tells us, wherefore, he is able. Who is able? Jesus Christ is able to save them to the uttermost, completely. That come unto God by him. How many believe that Jesus is the only way to be saved?
Amen.
Amen.
Why? Why? Because he died for our sins. But he rose on the third day. And here in Hebrew, it says, seeing he ever liveth to make intercession for them. Jesus is our high priest. Jesus is our mediator. Jesus is our intercessor between us and God the Father. He's able to save you if you come to him. Again, there are religions that teach because he died on the cross, everyone is automatically saved. That's not what it says here. It says here, you better come to God by him. He's standing with his arms wide open, saying, come. You've got to do something. Come to him. Why? Because he is our intercessor. He is our intercessor. So now we've just answered that question with the word of God. Does everyone need to be saved? It's one thing to say it, but we want to make sure we have scriptures from the word of God to back up what we're saying. And again, there are many more scriptures that confirm what we believe. But if they're not going to believe these, they're not going to be anything else. And nothing else at all. So, let me ask a question. If people truly believe that it is essential for everyone to be saved, and salvation can only be obtained through Jesus Christ, because the consequence of sin is death, as we have just discussed, the second death. If people truly believe this, why is that folks are not getting saved? Let's talk about that for a moment. Why do you think, or why do you feel that people do not want to be saved? Anyone want to comment?
I don't think some people believe in that there is a second coming, you know? I think people just think that it's done, and once you're buried, you're gone. That's it. They don't believe that Jesus Christ is the Lord and Savior, that he's here to save us from our sins, and we've died on the cross. They just believe that they're going to live their life, and if they die, they die. That's it. You
know? Yeah. Thank you, Deacon. Anyone else wants to add why people don't want to be saved?
I think people are so comfortable doing things that are against the word, and they just don't want to stop because they really feel like that is something that they need to do, and that keeps them going. And they know it's against it, and they just don't want to stop doing everything that's totally against the word because they know it's wrong. They just don't want to stop doing it.
Thank you.
Yeah, hey, let me chime in.
Yes.
I know, you know, being in my sin when I was in my sin, you gotta be careful because the mind is a dangerous thing. Remember, this is a spiritual thing for us. This ain't an intellectual thing. Yeah. And you don't really see till after you really come out your sins. And you get the Holy Spirit and you see the fullness of everything. And a lot of people, see, this is the only thing that's going to set you free. This word tells you everything's going to happen and most people still don't believe it. You really don't understand it until you believe it. After you believe it, then you'll be able to understand it. But you're never going to be able to understand it unless you come, let this great man, minister, teach you. and then you be able to understand it, and then you be able to believe it. But you gotta have somebody, like the Bible said, like our pastor, you, faith come by what? Most people ain't really hearing you too. They hear everything else. They hear everybody get saved. They hear everybody going to heaven. They hear everybody going to the left. But the last thing I want to say is that it says here, wherefore he's able to save them to the utmost that comes unto God by him. That word can't be changed. I thought everybody get saved. I thought everybody go to heaven. I thought Jesus died and everybody get to go ascend up. That ain't what the word said. The word said he gonna do that to the utmost who comes to God through Christ.
Right.
This, I read it like I've never read it before because man, my eyes are like so open. I cry myself to sleep every night because the truth is so. I was like, man, I could have lost my soul.
Yeah.
And I was in church my whole life. But now, I don't play around, y'all. I don't play around with the word. I don't play around with God. I don't play around with Christ. I was playing before. I ain't playing now.
No.
No playing.
Well, this is why we as being people of God who believe the word, we believe the word, and we are followers of Jesus Christ. And when we read what's going to happen to those that are unsaved, it's hard. And we all have family members. We all have friends. We all have acquaintances. We people that we may not even know. We've got to be concerned about everyone. We got work to do. Our job is to tell people that you need to be saved. But we are to tell people that will listen and believe. As you all said a moment ago, the reason why people will not get saved is because there is some doubt there. Because if you truly and really believe that there is a second death according to the word of God, that you will be burning forever. If people really believe that this was true, they would do something to make sure they don't go there. And we know the only answer is Jesus Christ. This is the problem we have in the church. Let's talk about that for a moment. If church people, church folks, truly believe this was going to happen to those that do not live right, do not live holy, do not love, are hypocrites, liars, thieves, fornicators, adulterers, if people truly believe that when you do these things, your final destination is the second death, the lake of fire, as stated in Revelation 21 and 8. If people really believe this, people would be better. You would do all you can. We would do all we can. First of all, we'll be thanking God and Jesus every day of our lives. And asking God, what must I do to continue on this straight and narrow way in order that I don't have to go to this place? which is called the second death. And the reason why is because churches don't teach us anymore. So there's no concern. Now people are teaching everybody's going to heaven. It's okay, be transparent. We know no one is perfect. But the question always is, what are you doing? And if you're doing something that you know is sin and it's going to keep you out of heaven and send you to this lake of fire, if you truly believe this, you will stop doing that. But thank God for those of us that do believe it.
Yes, yes.
And we got to do all we can to help our family, our friends, people on your job. And again, you talk to those that will listen. If they will not believe this, there's nothing you can do.
Right, right.
Nothing you can do. Why? Why? Because we must always remember God has given everyone free choice, free will, and free choice to be saved. Why? Because I will always say this. This scripture is one of the most important, if not the most important scripture in the Bible, John 3:16. For God so loved the world. If you don't know any other scripture in the Bible, you should know this. God loves everybody. And he loved us so, as this scripture tells us, that he gave his only begotten Son. There's only one begotten Son of God, and his name is Jesus. Amen. You must believe in Jesus, the one who God sent to sacrifice his life for our sins.
Amen.
That whosoever believeth, there's the choice. God of the universe has given everyone a choice. Now, if God wanted to make everyone believe, he could. He's God. But that goes against who he is and what he has done for us and how he has made us in his image and likeness. He gave us all free will. Free will means free choice. But he says, whosoever believeth in him who? Jesus Christ. You will not perish. Believeth in him should not perish. Perish how? Well, we go back to Revelation 21:8. And what Jesus said in Matthew 25:41. God does not want anyone to be lost. And there's nothing that you have done that you cannot be forgiven for. And when he forgives you, it's over.
Right.
It's done. You don't still continue to do it.
That's it right there.
Yeah.
And with the buzzword now, God is working on me. How long he has to work on you?
Right.
Before you get it right. No, that's just an excuse.
Correct.
Because you want to continue doing what you enjoy. And what you enjoy is sin. it's one thing to try to fool others, but it's a bad thing when you're fooling yourself.
That's right. Amen.
That's why we must know the truth.
Right.
That's the only thing that can set us free and will set us free is the truth. But have everlasting life. And we know everlasting life is only through Jesus Christ.
Amen.
Let us pray. Father God, in the name of Jesus, we say thank you, God, for your word. We thank you, God, that you love us, that you gave us Jesus Christ, your son, to die for our sins. And he rose on the third day. And the Bible says he is seated at the right hand of God the Father, making intercession for us. God, help us to continue to read and study your word. We want to receive eternal life, not eternal damnation. We thank God that we can say we are believers. And by the blood of Jesus Christ, we are saved.
Yes.
And we say thank you.
Thank you.
That we are saved. And will receive everlasting life.
Yes.
God bless us. God keep us.
Yes.
In your tender loving care. And we will always give your name the praise and the glory. And the honor. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen.